Hello all, in this presentation we are going to discuss about the definitions in community medicine. One of the reasons many of us find community medicine difficult because of these definitions. Probably community medicine is the subject in medicine having more definitions. I have given the link of the PDF of these definitions in the description section. You can use it for future references. In this presentation, we are not going to discuss the definitions derived from formula like range, where it is defined as the difference between the maximum value and minimum value. Various ratios like sex ratio, maternal mortality ratio have been defined as the ratio of the numerator to the denominator. Here the numerator will be defined as per the operational definitions or criteria. In rate, numerator will be a part of the denominator and rate is expressed in a specified time. In this presentation, definitions of rate, ratio and differences derived from formula are not discussed. Since these definitions are made easy only when we discuss with the formulas. Personally, I am against the concept of memorizing the definitions, and it is unfair to assess the students in exams and viva based on this recalling ability of these definitions. But in day-to-day practice, if you don't remember, recollect in exams and viva, you are not going to score well in exams and viva. Now, I have three ideas to make this difficult task simple. Number one is to understand the definition. You have to understand the definition properly. As Einstein have told, when you understand things clearly, then you can explain it clearly. Then number two is divide the topics into parts. In almost all the definitions, there would be a particular number of concepts which are contained. You have to divide these concepts and try to remember in sequence. Number three is to make a mnemonic for this definition. Wherever standard definitions are not existing, you can make your mnemonic of your own and try to remember these definitions. So I am going to the definitions. The most important repeatedly asked definition is the definition of the health. Health is a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being. We used to say community medicine is PSM, preventive and social medicine. So PSM, you can remember PSM, that is physical, social and mental well-being. And here the complete word will be missed many of the time by the students. So health is a state of complete physical, mental and social well-being, and not merely in the absence of disease or infirmity. So here I have divided the definition into two. One is health is the state of complete physical, mental and social well-being, and not merely in the absence of disease or the infirmity. And the third point, which is recently added into this definition, is which is optionally you can add, which will permit them to lead a socially and economically productive life. So these two are the important content of the definition of health, and this is optionally needed for the students. So now the next important definition is about the epidemiology. It is the study of epidemiology. Means epi means upon, demi means people, logi means study. So upon people study, it is a study among people. So the study of distribution and determinants of health related states and events in specified population, and the application of the study to control the health problems. It is as simple as that. So how we are going to remember is the study of distribution and determinants. These are all the core terms which we tend to forget. The study of distribution and determinants of health related states or events in a specified population, and application of the study to control the health problems. So that is epidemiology. Now the next, we are moving to epidemic. It is, epi means upon, demic means people. So next is epidemic. So the occurrence of an illness or the health related events in a community or a region clearly in excess of the normal expectancy. So this word is most important in this definition, that is excess of normal expectancy. Even when the case is not present, even a single case is not present in that community, you find a single case, that will be considered as a epidemic. So the occurrence of an illness or health related events in a community or a region clearly in excess of normal expectancy is called as an epidemic. Now the next definition is for screening. The search for unrecognized disease or defect. You have to remember here, it is the search for unrecognized disease or the defect by the means of rapidly applied simple tests, examinations and other procedures in apparently healthy individuals. So we are looking for an unrecognized disease or defect by means of rapidly applied tests, examinations or procedures in apparently healthy individuals. That is called a screening. So what is screening? It is the search for unrecognized disease through the rapidly applied tests, examinations and other procedures in apparently healthy individuals. So that is called a screening. In screening, we have two other important definitions, that is sensitivity and specificity. For remembering sensitivity, you have to remember this phrase, that is positivity in disease and specificity, it is negativity in health. So when we remember positivity in health, it is sensitivity is the ability of the test to detect the true positives among the deceased. Specificity is the ability of the test to detect the true negatives among the healthy. So now you look at the definition, the ability of the test to identify correctly all those who have the disease that is true positive. You can modify this way, the ability of the test to correctly identify the true positives among the deceased. And here, the ability of the test to correctly identify the true negatives among the healthy, that is those who do not have the disease. Now we are moving to the primary healthcare. Primary healthcare, probably this primary healthcare and essential healthcare are the two important definitions which will be lengthy and little difficult to remember. I have attempted to divide it into parts, so four parts each. So primary healthcare, the first two points of this primary healthcare is based on the principles of the primary healthcare. We all know principles of the primary healthcare is appropriate technology, community participation, equitable distribution and intersectoral coordination. So it is derived from these two. So primary healthcare is the essential healthcare based on practical, scientifically sound and socially acceptable methods and technology. This is the appropriate technology made universally accessible to the individuals and families in the community through their full participation. So this is community participation and at a cost that the community and the country can afford. So cost is, the cost factor is coming in here to maintain at every stage of their development in the spirit of the self-determination. So this is the primary healthcare definition. Many of this primary healthcare definition will exclude this line. If you want, you can end here. But the actual definition given by WHO consists of these four parts. That is, it is the essential healthcare which is decided based on the practically, scientifically sound and socially acceptable methods and technology made universally accessible to the, that is, universally accessible, it will include equitable distribution also, and the families in the community through their full participation and at the cost that the community and the country can afford to maintain at every stage of their development in the spirit of the self-determination. This last one is optional, as I told earlier. So these three are the important in case of primary healthcare. Now we are moving into health education. It is a process aimed at encouraging the, so to understand the health education, you should know about the behavior change communication, that is the motivation model. Health education is a process aimed at encouraging people to want to be healthy, to know how to stay healthy, to do what they can do individually and collectively to maintain health, and to seek help when needed. So here the four parts, it is a process aimed at encouraging the people to want to be healthy. First of all, they want to be healthy, to know how to stay healthy, to do what individually and collectively to maintain health, and to seek help when needed. So it is to want to be healthy, to know how to stay healthy, to do individually and collectively to maintain health, and to seek help when needed. So that is about health education. Now we are moving to the next definition, that is confounding factor. Confounding factor is a factor which is associated with both exposure and disease, and it is distributed unequally among the study group and the control group. So confounding factor is a factor. Usually we will do matching in case control study for this confounding factor. This confounding factor will mislead, and it will lead to the confounding bias. So it is associated with the both the exposure and the outcome, that is exposure and the disease, but it will be distributed unequally among the study group and the control group, and finally you tend to give a conclusion that because of this factor the outcome has appeared, but actually it is a confounder which is present in the study group and the control group unequally. So that is called as confounding factor. And confounding factor, to eliminate confounding factor, we do matching in case control studies. So association, what is defined as association is the concurrence of two variables more often than would be expected by the chance. There will be always concurrence of two variables expected by chance. If it is excess of this expected chance, then we call it as association. The concurrence of two variables more often than would be expected by chance is called as association. Now, the next topic is the risk factor. It is defined as an attribute or an exposure that is significantly associated with the development of the disease. The attribute or the exposure that is significantly associated with the development of the disease. So, any factor which is associated significantly with the development of the disease is called as the risk factor. So any attribute or the exposure that is significantly associated with the development of a disease. Now we are moving to the source of infection. Source of infection can be a person, animal, or an object or a substance from which the infectious agent passes or disseminated into the host. So here the definition, the important word here is the infectious agent passes or it is disseminated to the host. Infectious agent is passed or disseminated to the host. It can be a person, animal, object, or a substance. A reservoir. Any person, animal, arthropod, plant, soil, or substance, or combination of this, in which the infectious agent lives and multiplies, then we call it as a reservoir. And when it depends primarily for survival, and where it reproduces itself in such manner that it can be transmitted to a susceptible host. So it will wait for a time to reach this susceptible host to cause the disease to complete the life cycle. So that animal or a person or an arthropod or a plant or a soil or a substance will be called as a reservoir. A reservoir is any person, animal, arthropod, plant, soil, or the substance wherein the infectious agent lives and multiplies, on which it depends primarily for survival, and where it reproduces itself in such manner that it can be transmitted to a susceptible host. Now we are moving into the case, a definition of a case. It is a person in the population or a study group identified as having the particular disease or a health disorder or a condition under investigation, whom we call as the case is a person having a particular disease or a disorder or a condition under investigation. A person in the population or a study group identified as having a particular disease, health disorder, or a condition under investigation. And we are moving to the carrier. Carrier is an infected person or animal that harbors a specific infectious agent harbors a specific infectious agent in the absence of any discernible clinical disease and serves as a potential source of infection for others. Here, source of infection may be a source of infection, maybe, as we all know, in chain of infection, source of infection may be a case or a carrier. But here in carrier, it is a source of infection without any clinical disease and harbors the specific infectious agent. So, carrier is an infected person or animal that harbors a specific infectious agent in the absence of discernible clinical disease and serves as a potential source of infection for others. We are moving to the vector. Vector is an arthropod or any living carrier that transmits an infectious agent to a susceptible individual. It just transports the infectious agent to the susceptible individual. It can be further divided into biological vector or mechanical vector. Mechanical vector is just a mechanical transmission, just by touch it transmits mechanically. Biological vector, the infectious agent undergo a change in the stage of its life cycle, then it will be called as a biological vector. But as a vector, as a general, is an arthropod or a living carrier that transports an infectious agent to the susceptible individual. Now we are moving to the incubation period. Incubation period is the time interval between the invasion of an infectious agent and the appearance of the first symptom of the disease, symptom or sign of a disease. So it is the time interval between the invasion of an infectious agent and appearance of the first sign or the symptom of the disease in question. So that is called as incubation period. And there are other definitions which we have to understand by sequentially by this flow diagram. If A is the entry of an agent into a host, B is the after the entry of the agent into the host, the shredding of the agent from the host starts. Then after this clinical manifestation starts, then the host reaches the maximum infectivity, that the host sheds the agent to the maximum level. Then the clinical disease ends, then the shredding of the agent also ends. So these are all the various stages in entry of an agent to a clinical disease and to the shredding escape of the organism. Here A to B is called as the latent period, that is the entry of the organism to the shredding of the agent start is called as the point where the shredding of the agent start is called as the latent period. And A to C, that is entry of the organism to the appearance of first clinical symptom, is called as the incubation period. And A to D, that is the entry of the organism to the maximum infectivity, is called as the generation time. C to E, that is the maximum, that is the clinical manifestation starting to the clinical manifestation ending, that is called as clinical phase. And B to F, that is shredding of the agent starts to the shedding of the agent ends, that is called as the period of communicability. And B to C, that is shedding of the agent starting point to the clinical manifestation starting point, this is called as the incubatory carrier phase. Incubatory carrier phase. And E to F, that is the clinical disease ends and the shedding of the agents also ends. So this is called as a convalescent carrier phase. This is called as incubatory carrier phase. This is the clinical phase. Subclinical phase, that is C2F, or the healthy carrier phase, that is C2F, that is clinical manifestation starts and the shredding of the agent ends. So these are all the various stages in defining. Now we are moving into the disease control. The disease control, these are all the various stages in eradication or removal of the disease. So eradication is the last stage, disease control is the first stage. So in disease control, the agent is permitted to persist in the community at a level where it ceases to be a public health problem, or it is no more a public health problem in the community according to the tolerance of the population. According to the tolerance of the population. What is the disease control? It is the agent exists or it is permitted to survive in the community at a level where it is no more a public health problem according to the tolerance of the population. So that is called as the disease control. In disease elimination phase, it is interruption of the transmission of the disease. So here in control, we just allowed to persist in the community. But in elimination, the interruption of the transmission has happened. So transmission has been interrupted by the program, the control measures by the program. In disease eradication, it is the complete termination of all transmission of infection by the extermination of the infectious agent. That is, the agent is not, the agent will not exist in the world. So that is by the extermination of the infectious agent. So termination of all transmission of infection by extermination of the infectious agent is called as a disease eradication. Now we are moving to monitoring and surveillance, an important two marker where we can get either monitoring or surveillance, and difference between monitoring and surveillance. Monitoring is the routine measurements, performance and analysis of the routine measurements. It is the performance and analysis of the routine measurements aimed at detecting the changes in the environment or the health status of the population. For example, the indicators of the air quality will be considered as the air quality monitoring, or growth monitoring we say. That is, the growth is the normally occurring in any child. So if we do a performance and analysis of routine measurements of the growth aimed at detecting the changes in the environment or the health status of the population, then it will be called as the monitoring. Surveillance means it is the continuous scrutiny of the factors that determine the occurrence and distribution of the disease. It is a factor which will be measured to see the abnormal presence of the disease or a condition. So it is a continuous scrutiny of the factor. So for example, HIV surveillance or TB surveillance is a continuous scrutiny of the factors that determine the occurrence and distribution of the disease and other conditions of ill health. So that is the surveillance. It is not the routine measurement. So that is the most different point. So the continuous scrutiny of the factors that determine the occurrence and distribution of disease and other diseases of ill health. Now, community diagnosis. The pattern of disease in a community described in terms of important factors which influence this pattern. The pattern of disease in the community described in terms of important factors which influence the pattern. So that is called as community diagnosis. Then primary prevention, secondary prevention and tertiary prevention. Primary prevention is what the classical prevention which is described in English literature. That is, the action taken prior to the onset of the disease, possibility that the disease will ever occur. Primary this prevention is the action taken prior to the onset of the disease which removes the possibility that a disease will ever occur. Secondary prevention is after the disease occurs, you halt the progress of the disease at its incipient stage and prevent complications. So it is the action which halts the progress of the disease at its incipient stage and prevent its complication. That is called as secondary prevention. Tertiary prevention is the all measures available to reduce or limit impairments. We say in levels of intervention of this thing, primary prevention, it is health promotion and specific protection, early diagnosis and adequate treatment, disability limitation and rehabilitation. So here we have to limit the impairments and disability, minimize suffering caused by the existing departures from the good health, and to promote the patient's adjustment to the irremediable conditions. That is, the rehabilitation, you make the patient to pre-disease condition. Now, impairment, any restriction or lack of ability to perform an activity in a manner or within the range considered normal for a human being. So impairment is a restriction or lack of ability to perform an activity in the manner or within the range considered normal for a human being. Handicap is a disadvantage for a given individual resulting from an impairment or the disability. So what impairment is a restriction or the lack of ability, and the disadvantage gained out of this impairment or a disability is called as the handicap, that limits or prevents the fulfillment of a role that is normal for that individual depending upon the age, sex, social and cultural factors. So that is the disadvantage for a given individual is called as a handicap. Rehabilitation, the combined and coordinated use of medical, social, educational and vocational measures. So we have four measures, that is medical, social, educational and vocational measures for training and retraining the individual to the highest possibility of functional ability. So our ultimate goal is to make the person place in the position before the disease have occurred. So that is the ultimate goal of the rehabilitation. So combined and coordinated use of, so it is not only the combined but coordinated use of medical, social, educational and vocational measures for the training and retraining the individual to the highest possibility of functional ability. Now we are moving to the life expectancy. The number of, that is the average number of years that would be lived by a person who is born alive into the population if current age specific mortality rates persist. So what is life expectancy is nothing but the average number of years a person can live in the particular population with the currently existing age specific mortality rates. So it is the average number of years that will be lived by those born alive into a population if the current age specific mortality rates persist. Now diarrhea, it is a passage of loose, liquid or watery stools. It is what is cohort is defined as the group of people who share a common characteristic or experience within a defined time period. So for example, batch of 2016 is a cohort, 2016 cohort we can say. So is defined as the group of people who share a common characteristic or experience within a defined time period. As we all know, cohort is a word derived from the Roman army, where group of people with similar characteristics have been described as a cohort. Now coronary heart disease, otherwise called as ischemic heart disease. It is the impairment of the heart function due to the inadequate blood flow to the heart compared to its needs caused by obstructive changes in the coronary circulation to the heart. So what it ultimately means is the mismatch between the need and the supply. There is an existing mismatch between the need and the supply. So impairment of the heart function due to the inadequate blood flow to the heart compared to its needs caused by obstructive changes, by the obstructive changes in the coronary circulation to the heart is defined as the coronary heart disease. So any impairment in heart function due to the inadequate blood flow, which is again obstructive changes in the coronary circulation to the heart, is defined as a coronary heart disease or ischemic heart disease. Stroke is defined as a rapidly developed clinical signs of focal neurological disturbance or focal disturbance of cerebral function lasting for more than 24 hours. If it is less than 24 hours, we call it as a TIA, that is transient ischemic attacks. When it is less than 24 hours or leading to death with no apparent cause other than vascular origin. When we cannot identify any other cause other than vascular origin, we call it as a stroke. So that is, it is the rapidly developed clinical signs of focal disturbance of cerebral function lasting more than 24 hours or leading to death with no apparent cause other than the vascular origin is considered as a stroke. This is the WHO definition for stroke. Now the definition for obesity: an abnormal growth of the adipose tissue due to the enlargement of the fat cell size, that is hypertrophic obesity, or an increase in fat cell number, that is called as hyperplastic obesity, or a combination of both. So obesity is defined as abnormal growth of the adipose tissue, which may be due to the increase in size or increase in number. If it is increase in size, it is called as hypertrophic obesity. If it is increase in number, it is called as hyperplastic obesity. But the core word is the abnormal growth of adipose tissue due to increase in number or increase in size or a combination of both. Blindness, as defined by WHO, it is a visual acuity of less than 3/60 according to Snellen or its equivalent. Anything which is according to Snellen, if it is 3/60 or less than 3/60, then we call it as visual impairment as blindness. So visual acuity of less than 3/60 is null and or its equivalent will be considered as blindness. Accident, any unexpected, unplanned occurrence which may involve in injury is called as accident. Compliance, the extent to which the patient behavior coincides with the clinical prescription. The behavior is defined, further defined in terms of taking medicines, following diets or executing other lifestyle changes. So, the extent to which the patient behavior coincides with the clinical prescription, the patient behavior is maybe taking medicine or following diets or executing lifestyle changes. Maternal death. So, here maternal death is any death of a woman while pregnant or within 42 days of termination of pregnancy, irrespective of the duration and site of the pregnancy, from any cause related to or aggravated by the pregnancy or its management, but not from accidental or incidental causes. So, that is defined as a maternal death. Within 42 days is considered as maternal deaths. So, problem village. Problem village is a village. It is mainly based on the water. So, source of water. When there is no source of water is available within a distance of 1.6 km. This is nothing but 1 mile. In 1 mile, if you don't get any safe water source, then you can call it as a problem village. Also, or where the water is available at the depth of more than 15 meters, or the water source has excess salinity, iron, fluorides and other toxic elements, or where the water is exposed to the risk of cholera, you call it as a problem village. You call it as a problem village based on the four water supply requirement. Then the family planning. Family planning is a way of thinking and living that is adopted voluntarily. It is a way of thinking and living that is adopted voluntarily upon the basis of knowledge, attitude and responsible decisions by the individuals and the couple. So, it is by the individuals and the couples and it is not the prescriptions given by the healthcare providers. So, they have to gain knowledge and their attitudes have to be changed and the responsible decisions by the individuals and the couples, which should be adopted voluntarily in order to promote the health and welfare of the family group and thus contribute effectively to the social development of the country. Or our ultimate goal is to socially develop the country. So that principles have to be imparted and adopted voluntarily. So a way of the family planning is a way of thinking and living that is adopted voluntarily upon the basis of knowledge, attitudes and responsible decisions by the individuals and couples in order to promote the health and welfare of this family group and thus contribute effectively to the social development of a country. Now we are moving to culture. Culture is the learned behavior which has been socially acquired. It is the learned behavior that has been socially acquired. Psychology. Psychology is the study of human behavior, of how people behave and why they behave in the way they do. So, psychology is a study of human behavior, of how and why they behave in such a way. So, there are many other descriptions for the terms which is given in sociology. These are all not given as definitions, but it is better to define those words, for example, habit or learning or emotion in the terms which is given in the will describe the terms better. So, operational research, the application of the scientific methods of investigation to the study of complex human organizations and services. The application of scientific methods of investigation to the study of complex human organizations and services. The drug, any substance that when taken into a living organisms may modify one or more of its functions. So, drug is defined as any substance that taken into the living organism may modify one or more of its function is called as a drug. And what is defined as a drug abuse? It is the self-administration of a drug for non-medical reasons in quantities and frequencies which may impair an individual's ability to function effectively and which may result in social, physical and emotional harm. So, what is a drug abuse? It is a self-administration of the drug for non-medical reason in quantities and frequencies which may impair the individual's ability to function effectively, which may result in social, physical or emotional harm. Social, physical or emotional harm. This is called as a drug abuse. What is a drug addiction? It is a state of periodic or chronic intoxication which is detrimental to the individual and society produced by repeated intake of habit forming drugs. So it is a state of periodic or chronic intoxication detrimental to the individual and the society produced by the repeated intake of habit forming drugs. Health information. A mechanism for collecting, processing, analysis and transmission of information required for organizing and operating health services and also for research and training. So what is health information? It is a mechanism of collection, processing, analysis and transmission of information required for organizing and operating health services and also for research and training. That is called as health information. What is census? The process of collecting, compiling and publishing demographic, economic and social data pertaining at the specified time or times to all persons in the country or a delimited territory. So it is to the all persons. So that is very important. So the total process of collecting, compiling and publishing demographic, economic and social data pertaining at the specified time or times to all persons in a community or delimited territory. Social security. Security that society furnishes through appropriate organization against certain risks to which its members are exposed. Maybe an accident, maybe a death. So social security that society furnishes through appropriate organization against certain risks to which its members are exposed. Population genetics. The study of the precise genetic composition of the population and various factors determining the incidence of inherited traits in them. So what is population genetics? It is the study of precise genetic composition of the population and the factors determining the incidence of inherited traits in them. Objective. What is an objective? Objective, it is either achieved or not. It is a planned endpoint of all activities. You have to define in this way. It is a planned endpoint of all activities. What is a target? It often refers to a discrete activity, such as number of films collected or vasectomies done. It is a discrete activity. For example, you becoming a good doctor will be a goal. You have to pass in third year will be an objective. You have to study 8 to 10 hours per day will be a target. So you have to become a good doctor will be a goal. Pass this year will be an objective, which ultimate desired state towards your objectives and resources are directed. It is the ultimately desired state. This is planned endpoint of all activities, that is objective. The target refers to the discrete activity. And goal is an ultimate desired state towards all your objectives and resources are directed. Food fortification. The process whereby nutrients are added to the foods to maintain or improve the quality of the diet of a group, a community or a population. The process whereby nutrients are added to the food in relatively small quantities to maintain or improve the quality of the diet of a group, a community or a population. So now we are nearing the end of the presentation. So modern preventive medicine, it is nothing but you have to combine all the levels of interventions into the definition for modern preventive medicine. That is the art and science of health promotion. And health promotion is health promotion, disease prevention, disability limitation and rehabilitation is the modern preventive medicine. What is family medicine? The focus here is the family, called as the first contact physicians. It is a field of specialization in medicine which is neither disease nor organ oriented, but it is a family oriented medicine or healthcare centered on the family as an unit. From first contact to the ongoing care of chronic problems, from prevention to rehabilitation. Now, what is community medicine? definition for community medicine in part textbook, so which I have given. The specialty which deals with the populations. The specialty which deals with the populations and comprises those doctors who try to measure the needs of the population, both sick and well, that is ill and the well. Illness and the wellness component will be measured. They plan and administer the services to meet the needs of the population, and those who are engaged in research and the teaching in the field. So here there are three components. One is they deal with population. They identify the needs, plan and administer services for these needs. And second one is research. Third one is teaching. So what does the community medicine people do? It is a specialty which deals with the population and comprises those doctors who try to measure the needs of the population, both sick and the well, and they plan and administer services based on the needs which was measured, and those who are engaged in research and teaching in the field. So they are the field of community medicine. Now, the healthcare, it is defined as a multitude of services, that is the many services which is rendered to the individuals, families and the communities by the agents of health services or professionals for the purpose of promoting, maintaining, monitoring or restoring health. So that is called as healthcare. Healthcare is the auxiliary worker. It is defined as the one who less than a full professional qualification in a particular field and is supervised by a professional worker. So their work will be supervised and their qualification will be the less than the full professional qualification. Auxiliary nurse midwives are created. So that is they are the nurses, but their qualification will be less than the nurses, but their work will be supervised by the nurses. So that is called as auxiliary worker. So here are some of the definitions which is given in the index page of the PARC textbook, and the red ones are the ones which we have discussed. As I told earlier, rate ratio and proportions have not been discussed in this presentation because they are just the formulas. You have to include ratio of the numerator to the denominator in a specific time for a rate, and any numerator and denominator can be included in ratio. And then for other differences like ranges and range and all, we have not discussed. But here the red ones have been discussed. All these red ones have been discussed. Black ones we have not discussed. And so here are the some of the continuation. So what we missed is given in the end. So you can refer the textbook for defining these definitions. So thank you for watching this video. Hopefully this presentation was useful to you. If you haven't subscribed to the Think Lateral channel, please subscribe and click on the bell icon for further videos. The further videos coming up next week are mnemonics in community medicine and important health days and facts about those health days. So the mnemonics and community medicine will be helpful in exam point of view, both in theory, viva, and also in PG preparation. Thank you.